Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder in the Oval Library by C.M. Gleason. Read by Barry Press. Chapter 1. At 5 o'clock in the afternoon, the telegraphic wire brought the long-looked-for intelligence that war has begun, and that the forces of the Confederated traitors have struck the first blow. Many had hoped the contest might yet be avoided. Others thought the federal government would back down rather than shed blood, and others were certain that a divine providence would interfere to prevent so fratricidal a strife. The feeling of rejoicing was everywhere to be met, that Major Anderson had not lowered his flag, and that President Lincoln had determined to sustain, even at so fearful a cost, the honor of the country. New York Times, April 13, 1861, reporting on the firing upon Fort Sumter. April 14, 1861, Washington, D.C. The Capitol was hardly more than a bedraggled swamp, lined with muddy, unpaved roads and studded with a few stately buildings. The Capitol, appearing half-dressed with its unfinished dome, the President's House, the Treasury, and the Smithsonian Institution. Despite all the grand plans of its American forefathers from less than a century before, Washington City remained the ugly, simple stepsister of Philadelphia, New York City, New Orleans, and Charleston. Today, a mild Sunday in mid-April, the unpaved streets were thronged with people crowded around bulletin boards. Some were clustered in the drinking rooms of the largest hotels, worrying, arguing, or celebrating, depending on the side with which each sympathized. For word had come via telegraph late yesterday, and news was still trickling in. The war had begun. Adam Speed Quinn, a new and reluctant resident of the small, muddy capital, had no need to stop and read the notices on the boards to try and buy one of the few unsold newspapers or to crowd around the bar counter at Willard's to get updates on the news. He'd just come from the executive mansion and the private office of Mr. Lincoln himself. Because of this, Adam, at least, knew what was just beginning to dawn on the people of Washington. Their city would soon be invaded by the Confederate Army.
"Mr. Quinn," Birch, the elderly Negro doorman at the Willard Hotel, greeted him as he stepped aside for Adam to pass through to the lobby. His rheumy eyes were watery but sharp, and he stood erect in his uniform and spotless white gloves.
"You done seen the president, sir. Is he well?"
"I've just come from his side. I reckon he's the least rattled of anyone in the city right now, which ain't saying much."
Adam gave Birch a grim smile as the man touched his hat in greeting, then went on into the lobby. Though the roar of conversation and debate spilled from down the red-carpeted hall where the bar and men's restaurant were located, the fancy chandeliered lobby was nearly empty. Its lone occupant was a tall, lanky man of 47, with weather-beaten, sun-brown skin. He was dressed in a manner similar to Adam, in black trousers and a homespun, double-breasted cotton shirt with a creased leather vest over it. He held a wide-brimmed black hat in one hand, and from the looks of his messy, dark hair, it appeared that he had just recently removed it. Adam knew better. Jim Lane never combed his wild mop of hair and shaved only when he had to. That is, he claimed, when the stubble became too itchy. Thus, Lane always looked as if he'd just come in from one of the wild winds that stormed across the Kansas prairie. That appearance contributed to his reputation of being a brilliant war general who was more than slightly mad.
"Senator," Adam said as they embraced, clapping each other on the back vigorously, "glad to see you made it in one piece, and congratulations. If I'd still been in KT for the election, you'd have had my vote."
Thank you. And what's this senator nonsense? Lane said.
Though at 6'4", he towered over most men, he was just above eye level with the younger Adam.
You leave Kansas Territory to travel with the president, and you get all formal and citified?
Adam grinned. I reckon if you take a better look, you'll see I ain't been citified yet. He gestured to his scuffed, worn boots and the loose, knee-length frontier coat he'd not given up since coming to the Capitol.
Lane laughed.
You, me, and Abe Lincoln. We're proof you can't take the frontier out of the man once he's been there, I reckon.
Then he sobered.
Does he have any good idea what we're all up against?
The moment of easy humor passed, and Adam shook his head.
Hell, no one here does, Jim. No one who wasn't in Kansas knows how bloodthirsty and violent the pro-slavers are. The people here, no matter what side, are saying this'll be over by end of the summer, tops.
Adam gave a bitter laugh. You and I know better'n that.
I'll do whatever he needs, Lane said simply. You tell him that.
Lane and the president had become friends during Lincoln's speaking tour in Kansas only 18 months ago, in December 1859. At that time, Adam was barely recovered from the injury that took his arm, but he'd been with the future president while he traveled through Kansas and had introduced the two men.
That's why I'm here, besides that I needed to shake my new senator's hand, Adam's quick smile faded.
I heard most of your speech last night out there on the avenue. The crowd was too thick for me to get to you.
They had me standing at a rickety dry goods box out there on the street, and one of those bastards got close enough, tried to set me on fire.
He flapped the back of his battered coat at Adam, displaying a coin-sized burn mark near the hem.
Damn near fell on my arse because the crate tipped on the cobblestones.
Damn. But Adam wasn't surprised. The pro-slavers he'd encountered in Kansas were vicious and didn't hold back from any sort of violence. Better cobblestones and a rickety crate than standing in that swamp out past the president's house or in mud up to your ankles.
Thank God for small favors, although I reckon I didn't expect to see a pair of pigs walking along the street in the middle of the capital city.
That happens, Adam said with a quirk of his lips. They like to wallow behind City Hall in the square there. When Lane looked at him as if he wasn't certain whether to believe him, he added,
God's truth, sometimes there are even chickens gathered on the National Mall there.
Well, I'll be damned, Lane muttered. Lawrence is still more civilized than Washington. I thought that might have changed since I was here last. Anyway, I reckon your reputations preceded you here to the Capitol. All those Southern rebels know who you are, and they're telling tales. Adam had been at the outskirts of the crowd who'd gathered around Lane last night on the street, shortly after word had come of the fall of Fort Sumter. The new Kansas senator was nearly as well known nationally as the new president, and was equally feared and hated by the pro-slavers. He was legendary for being a little mad and very bold when it came to battle. Adam had seen his friend acting with both strategic, calculated moments as well as in a sort of feral, berserker sort of mood, both of which had sealed his reputation. However, he'd come away victorious. Lane was a national figure. He'd been called the General Washington of Kansas because of the way he'd successfully led a small number of frontier freedom fighters in months of battle against a large crew of Southern soldiers, as well as much of the federal government, both of which wanted to make Kansas a slave state. The Free Staters had finally won at the ballot box in 1859, but only after much death and bloodshed. Hatred for the man from Lawrence had followed the senator here, and last night, during Lane's impromptu speech, he'd nearly been mobbed by Southern sympathizers and other pro-slavers who knew Lane from Kansas. These antagonists threatened to hang him, but Adam and a dozen or so other loyalists put their hands on their revolvers, clicking the hammers in a sharp warning to those who wanted to start a riot. The troublemakers who were interspersed among the crowd realized suddenly they didn't know exactly who was standing next to them, ally or enemy. The cries and threats for hanging went silent for the moment.
"They're going to take the city, you know, Jim, the Confederates, as soon as Virginia secedes, and that's going to be any day now, I reckon. If Maryland goes too, there's no hope for Washington, caught as we are between the two states, and the city already mostly southern. All the rebels have to do is come across the Potomac. They're 800 feet away. 800 feet from taking the damn city."
Lane swore under his breath. "How many Union men you got here?"
"Lincoln's calling up the city militia, but damn it, they're most of them southerners themselves, and none of them are experienced in any sort of battle fighting. Half of them are older and fatter than my Aunt Gertrude. Even so, I reckon you ask if they'd actually fire on the Confederates, and that'd be like asking them to fire on a brother. Most of them surely are brothers or cousins."
"This is a damned thing, a damned thing."
Adam had kept these thoughts to himself when in the president's office, but they'd been haunting him for weeks. The whole country knew the war was inevitable ever since Lincoln had been elected. Once that had happened, there was no turning back. Though the new president clearly and repeatedly stated he had no intention of freeing the slaves in the South, people in those states didn't believe him. Even more than that, they wanted assurance that the peculiar institution of slavery would expand west along with the nation. That, however, was where Lincoln drew the line. He would not see slavery expand into any more territories or states. On that, he'd been clear. That was how he'd been elected. And that was why he'd been getting death threats, both openly and secretly, since the votes were counted.
"There's no one here to protect the city, then."
"Not enough, anyway. Not until more troops get here from the north, which could be a week or more. He's expecting 50,000 or more. He'll be publishing the official proclamation calling up the troops tomorrow, but who knows when they'll get here."
Lane looked grimmer than ever. "And in the meantime, those damn pro-slavers won't hesitate to shoot and kill anyone, brother or no."
Adam didn't need to verbalize his agreement. He was personally acquainted with violent pro-slavers like John Atchison and John Stringfellow, and it was Orrin Bitter, his red-headed cohort Leeward Hale, and their small gang who'd taken not only Adam's arm from him, but also the life of his best friend and more, Tom, Mary, and little Carl Stillwell. He tamped back the rise of memory, the grief that still hadn't gone, and returned his clear-eyed gaze to Lane. Both men and many of their friends and cohorts had experienced deep losses on the Kansas prairie. Because of that, they knew what to expect in a battle against Southern rebels who were determined to protect their way of life. There would be no quarter given. The secessionists would fight like savages. The rest of the country had no idea what they were about to face. But Adam and Jim Lane, and the other frontiersmen who'd fought with them, did. The Confederates won't wait. They'd be foolish to hesitate from attacking Washington. Everyone knows the city's not prepared and hardly protected. And when they take the city, Adam continued, speaking his worst fear aloud for the first time, they'll go for the president's house right off. He and Lane looked at each other. There was no need to say anything more. They'd both seen what the pro-slavers had done to the men they hated and considered their enemies. It wasn't just simple killing. There were tar and featherings, beatings, cuttings, hangings, and more. More often than not, those horrific actions had been unprovoked and retaliatory, not even taking place in the heat of battle. "They ain't gonna take the city, and they sure as hell ain't gonna take the president or his house," Lane said flatly. "I reckon Mr. Lincoln needs a special guard, and I reckon we're the ones to do it."
There's some good Free State Kansas fighters already here in Washington. I reckon they're ready to fight for the Union again.
Then let's rally up those frontiersmen to that big White House, Lane extended his weathered hand.
I already told Mr. Lincoln you'd say that. Adam shook his friend's hand firmly, feeling as if he finally had a true ally in town.
He's hesitant about garrisoning soldiers at the People's House. Doesn't want to upset the public, but I'll talk him into it.
I don't see how the president has any choice.
I don't reckon he does.
Thursday, April 18th. It wasn't until 4 days later, when word came that the Confederates had attacked the Union Armory at Harper's Ferry, less than 70 miles away, that the president was convinced to let Jim Lane bring his frontier fighters to the executive mansion. Although the outnumbered Union troops had done their best to keep the federal arsenal and weaponry from the hands of the rebels by setting fire to the Harper's Ferry Armory, that small town was now in the hands of the Confederates and far too close to Washington for comfort. Nearly 500 troops from Pennsylvania had arrived in the Capitol on the 7 o'clock train, and they'd be stationed at the Capitol and Treasury building. The colonel from Kentucky, Cassius Clay, had gathered a small group of 100 or so staunch Union men, and they were garrisoned at the Willard Hotel. Colonel Stone assigned Clay's men to patrol the streets, but Lane and Adam, along with Major David Hunter, had convinced the president he needed more security in the presidential residence. They all feared the Confederates would not hesitate to storm the executive mansion and kidnap or assassinate the president.
"It's a damned thing," Lincoln said as he, Hunter, and Adam greeted Lane at the main entrance to the house. "Having soldiers garrisoned inside the White House."
The president squinted a little and seemed particularly grave as he looked out over the motley troop of 60 soldiers assembled on the ellipse, the oval-shaped drive on the north side of the mansion. The men had just marched loudly and conspicuously along Pennsylvania Avenue from Willard's. Their shadows fell in long swaths behind them, for the sun was low to the horizon.
"Half the city's evacuated itself. The streets have been clogged with people taking all their belongings and getting out of town," said Adam, wondering about young Brian Mulcahy and his family.
The Mulcahys were poor Irish immigrants who lived in the mean, primitive alleys in the First Ward, just north of Lafayette Square and the President's House. Would they have left, too? Did they have any means or money to travel? Adam reckoned he could make the time to check on them tomorrow.
"We all know the rebels are coming. Word is they might be coming even tonight, but they won't take your house, Mr. President. Not while we're here," Lane said in an uncharacteristically formal manner.
"From your mouth to heaven's ear," replied Lincoln. The president stood in the grand foyer, just past the wizened Irishman Edward McManus, the doorman who'd worked for 7 presidents, and greeted each of the frontier fighters as they came in. Lincoln's hand was just as calloused and weathered as those he shook from the men determined to guard him, and though at 6'4" he loomed taller than all but Jim Lane, he was as informal and relaxed as they were in dress, manner, and words. To a man, each one greeted him with a steady gaze and a firm shake, expressing his honor at being called to this duty.
"I'll sleep outside your bedroom door," Lane said to the president when all his men had trooped through.
He adjusted the rifle he held over his shoulder and pulled back his coat to reveal the revolver tucked in a holster.
"I'll stay in the east room with the rest of the men," Major Hunter said.
And Adam, who considered himself an unofficial member of the Frontier Guard, as Lane had dubbed the men, agreed he would do the same.
"No uniforms," Lane replied,
when Secretary of War Cameron broached the subject of clothing and weapons for the Kansans.
"If they're in uniform, it's too easy for the enemy to count the exact number. Let the men stay in their own clothing so no one knows just how many we have. That's going to be important. We've got to give off that there's more of us than there are. As for the rifles and bayonets, we'll take as many as you can give us."
While the frontier guard was armed with rifles, bayonets, and ammunition, Adam took Lane to the second floor so he could get the lay of the land there. Though he didn't point it out, Adam was certain Lane saw in what disrepair the president's mansion was. Carpets were worn and threadbare in places, painting needed to be done most everywhere, and there were random water stains on the walls and ceiling. Some of the wainscoting was missing, and in other places it was coming loose. They didn't go into the green or blue rooms on the first floor, but Adam knew how sun-faded the draperies were and that the rugs were frayed. Mrs. Lincoln had created a mild scandal because of the cost of some furnishings she'd ordered from New York even before the inauguration, but the actual refurbishment had hardly begun. As they ascended to the second level, Adam and Lane passed a long line of men that led from the main floor up the stairs and along the hall. The line ended outside the waiting room to the president's office, with three chairs pushed up against the wall, where they were occupied by those who'd been waiting the longest. "Job seekers," Adam explained when he and Lane were alone in the Oval Library. An overturned pile of blocks indicated that Tad and Willie, the Lincolns' young sons, had been there recently. "There have been men lined up here since the day he moved in, and they stay until he meets with them or sends them home at night, then show up first thing at dawn the next day. Old Ed, you met him, the doorman, has been told to let them all in, no questions."
"These people just walk into the president's house without a by your leave and without any security? And they stay all day? What is he thinking? We're at war, for God's sake."
Adam shook his head. Nicolay and Hay, the two secretaries, and Ward Hill Lehman, who was his bodyguard until just recently, and I and Mrs. Lincoln and everyone else who has his ear says the same. But he won't have any of it. "It's the people's house," he says. Lane muttered something foul, then sighed and looked around as if seeing the place for the first time. Never seen an oval-shaped room before, especially one this big. The large room was outfitted as a library, but the Lincolns used it as a casual family room. Shelves lined the curved walls, and the last bit of light from the sunset filtered through the large windows and over the hundreds of book spines. Adam knew more crates were coming, for Lincoln, who treasured every book he'd ever owned, had spent over $1,000 on new volumes for the library. A large sofa and two comfortable armchairs had been placed in the center of the room, flanking a low table. There was plenty of floor space where Tad and Willie could play while their parents sat and talked, or while their father met informally with friends or advisors.
"Me neither," Adam replied. "Abe likes it because it's quiet and the boys can run around. There are a couple of ruffians," he added with a grin. "Willie, he's 10, and Tad must be 8 by now. I'm surprised we haven't seen or heard them yet. Mrs. Lincoln must have them occupied somewhere. Abe's office is down yonder, and the two secretaries, Nicolay and Hay, you met them, and Hay's the younger one, are next door to it. They bunk across the hall, and the family bedrooms are behind those doors we passed at the top of the stairs. There's that screen that blocks the hallway from the private side to the public, but you still walk past the bedchambers at the top of the stairs." "We'll be putting a guard at that screen," Lane said firmly, "and sending all those job seekers home. Abe'll do it for Mrs. Lincoln's sake and the boys, if for no other reason. She's the wife. I reckon she's got something to say about it."
"Speaking of wives, how is Mary and the children?" Adam asked with some trepidation, knowing that Lane and his wife had not only gone through an estrangement some time ago, but had even divorced in 56. They'd remarried 2 years later, but he knew things remained very tenuous between them. One thing he did know, however, was that Lane was very attached to his children, and had especially grieved over the death of his daughter Annie, who had died in Kansas.
"We're still married, but that's about all I can say on that," he replied brusquely. "The children are well, growing like weeds, healthy so far."
He looked at Adam and, lifting one of his thick, bushy brows, quickly changed the subject.
"What exactly is your position here? You never did say."
Adam gave a rueful laugh.
"That's because I reckon I don't quite know.
Abe asked me to stay on once my Uncle Joshua left after the inauguration. The two of them are old friends, and Josh gave him a place to stay when he first came to Springfield. I've known Abe nearly 20 years since I came to live with my uncle, so I was asked to be part of the bodyguard team when he traveled from Illinois to here. Then I got caught up by helping with a situation a few weeks ago."
"That man who was murdered at the inaugural ball?" Lane shook his head at Adam's surprise. "It was in the paper, even out to Lawrence, and so was your name. I reckon that makes you the president's personal investigator now, doesn't it?"
"Well, I've said that job belonged to Alan Pinkerton, but he's gone back to Chicago, so I reckon you might be right. But I can't say I'm interested in doing much more investigating of anything, to be frank. I'd have left Washington weeks ago, but Abe asked me to stay."
The president, who was like an honorary uncle, said because he'd known Adam since he was a boy, he knew he could trust him, and since he didn't have even a whiff of political aspiration, that made Adam even more valuable to him.
"You're the only person in this city who doesn't want anything from me," Lincoln told him.
Adam still wasn't certain how he felt about being cornered into staying in the city and dunked all the way into politics and formal gatherings and tight shoes, when all he wanted to do was get back to the wide open space of the frontier. But he was here, and here he'd remain, to serve and protect a man he loved and respected.
"I suppose now that war is officially on, I'm going to be enlisting pretty damned soon," Adam said, wondering if they'd even take him with his missing arm.
He gritted his teeth. "Probably not.
Unless the Rebs come in and end things quickly."
Lane, who'd been looking out the windows at the last bit of sun setting over the marshy ground beyond the house, turned back.
"The way I see it, our entire concept of democracy is at stake. If Washington falls, the American experiment of democracy does too."
"We're going to have to put on a big show for the Rebs," Adam replied.
"Scare the wool out of them. At least they know Jim Lane's Jayhawkers aren't afraid to pull a damned trigger. They'll think twice about attacking us." "That's right. If we make it through tonight, I'll recruit more men tomorrow. And we're going to do whatever we can to put out the word how many troops we got here. At least 300. Probably up to 400 by now."
Lane grinned darkly, pursing his lips. "I'll drop a few hints here and there at the bar counter at the St. Charles, too. That's the hotel where the Southerners mostly stay, and word'll get back to the Confederates that there's hundreds of angry Free Staters here at the mansion, experienced and ready to fight. For now, we've got just 60, but we'll make it look like more. Whether they invade tonight," he made a thoughtful sound.
Adam pointed out the window. "Just yonder, down the hill there and across the National Mall. You can't hardly see it right now in the dark. But the long bridge is there over the Potomac. That's where they'll come. 800 feet away across the river."
As he looked out into the twilight night, squinting to determine whether there was any sign of enemy troops gathering in the shadows, he saw the faint glow from a tower of the Smithsonian Castle, the sprawling Gothic-style building made from red-orange brick so different from all of the other white marble government structures, was right there, at the end of the long bridge. The fingers on Adam's real hand tightened. That building was the first place the Confederates would see when they came across. Though the president would be their ultimate target, the rebels could easily be distracted by the stately castle. And the occupants therein. But surely Joseph Henry, the director of the Smithsonian, had evacuated with his wife, daughters, and niece. But why was there still a light in one of the towers, in the East Tower, where the Henry family lived? Adam checked the revolver holstered at his waist, and then his pocket for ammunition. He'd grab himself an Enfield on the way out. "I'm going to take a few men down to the long bridge. It needs to be guarded. Maybe we'll make some ruckus, too. Give those ribs something to worry about." And while he was down there scouting, he'd find out who had a light on in the Smithsonian Tower. Chapter 2. Despite the rumors running rampant through the city, Sophie Gates wasn't particularly worried. At least, that was what she told herself. Even if the Confederates did cross over the Long Bridge and end up right in the shadow of the castle-like Smithsonian building, that didn't mean they'd have any reason to come inside it. And even if they did, Uncle Joseph was a Southern sympathizer, so he'd probably welcome the soldiers inside with open arms, if he ever came back from wherever he'd been for the past several hours, that is. Sophie considered turning down her lamp so as not to attract attention should the rebels make an appearance, but that would mean she couldn't write. And a journalist had to write. Here she was, in the East Tower apartments of the Smithsonian, with a bird's-eye view of Washington. The city was holding its collective breath, surely soon to be invaded. She'd have the most unique and broad perspective of whatever happened, and her report would be filled with important details and news. She'd telegraph the information up to New York, and then, finally, Horace Greeley and his Times would have to take notice of her stories. Of course, the reports would have to be submitted under her nom de plume, Henry Altman, because most people didn't think a woman journalist could write about anything other than gossip, fashion, or, she shuddered, housekeeping. But Sophie was bound and determined to prove them all wrong, and this could be her chance. If she had a quiver of nervousness about what might happen if the soldiers did come tonight, she refused to dwell on it. A newspaper correspondent had to take risks. And besides, she knew how to shoot the rifle she had loaded and rested against the wall behind her desk. She wasn't a fool. Nevertheless, Sophie couldn't completely quell a twitch of nerves about being alone here in the castle when or if the rebels invaded. So she forced herself to focus on the words she'd written so far. She planned to prepare two versions. A brief report with the most pertinent information, short and sweet, that could be telegraphed for instant receipt. And she'd also write a more detailed story to be sent by mail, to be printed in full later. It was that version to which she now gave her attention. As the sun sets on a chill, rainy April day, all ears are turned toward any sound that might herald the arrival of the Confederate traitors on the banks of the Potomac. If they dared cross the Long Bridge, the Union men of Washington City would meet them on the springy turf of the National Mall, and Sophie stilled, tensing. What was that noise? Her gaze went to the window, which faced northeast, over the mall. Heart thudding, she rose and, taking care to keep herself from being silhouetted by the lamp, peeked out from the edge of the glass. There was no sign of movement below, but she was looking toward the Capitol building. If the rebels came, they would cross the Long Bridge, barely a spit away to the south and west of her. Everyone said so, and Sophie had been listening to the rumors and arguments for days. The view of the Potomac and its bridge was from a different window than the one by her desk. Even though the night was cloudy from a day of rain, she might be able to make out some shapes and even count them. That would be good information. She started out of the room, then spun and came back for the rifle, just in case. As she hurried across the hall to the south-facing chamber, her aunt and uncle's bedroom, she heard the definite sounds of movement, thumping, clanking, thudding. It sounded like a massive army was marching over the wooden slats of the bridge. Inside, her stomach dropped and squished like a tub of wet laundry. The rebels are coming. Sophie gripped the rifle and tried to decide what to do. She was a woman alone in this huge building, which gave her many places to hide if necessary. But she was also a journalist. It was her task to get the story. She would be the first reporter to see the Confederate troops. She could get their numbers, perhaps identify and even count their weapons, even follow them and watch as everything played out. Though her heart was thudding wildly and her knees were a trifle weak, she knew this was her best chance to get a real story. She could be the first to get to the telegraph office and send word up to Mr. Greeley. Fired by determination, she began to make her way down the stairs of the tower, rifle still in hand. In the past, when seeking out a story, Sophie had often dressed as a man in an effort to be taken more seriously and to keep from attracting attention as a woman, particularly if she was going to places women generally weren't supposed to go. But tonight, she didn't have time to change out of the simple shirtwaist skirt and subdued crinoline she wore at home. She wasn't certain whether her obvious gender would help or hinder her if she came face to face with the Confederates, but she would surely find out. She was nearly to the bottom of the dark stairs when she heard a sound at the exterior door, a thunk, as if someone was trying to open it. Her heart skipped a beat and she paused, holding her breath, feeling the sound of her pulse ramming inside her ears. Uncle Joseph finally returning? Maybe he was drunk and was fumbling for the latch in the dark outside. Or was it the rebels, already determined to take over one of the government buildings as they had done all over the South? Sounds of marching over the bridge were louder and steadier now that she was on the ground floor and closer. Thud, thud, thud. How many were there? She swallowed hard. The door clunked quietly again. Surely, if it were the Confederates trying to get in, they'd be louder and bolder. Of course, Sophie had never experienced a war before or seen an army in action, unless you counted the gangs in New York. But she expected if a group of invading soldiers wanted access to a building, they wouldn't be particularly polite about it. They'd pound on the door, demand entrance, even break their way in. Maybe it was someone else who just needed a safe place to hide now that the Confederates were crossing into the city. Maybe Mr. Stimson, or another of the young naturalists who boarded at the Smithsonian in exchange for doing cataloging, had returned from their evacuation. These men, all of whom she knew, lived in the North Tower. But maybe someone had been locked out, not realizing everyone else had left the building and the city. These realizations emboldened her, and Sophie went to the door. She left a lamp on the table in the entrance, turned down just to the lowest glow to light the way for her uncle's return. Now, she regretted it, for the light would give whoever was outside the advantage of sight inside. Holding her rifle at the ready, she called, "Who's there?" as she peeked through the glass sidelight. It was too dark to see more than a silhouette, but there was only one. The man's shape was too long and slender to be her rotund Uncle Joseph, though. And it was holding something else, long and much more slender. A rifle. "Who's there?" she called again, edging to the window on the other side of the door to try a different angle. Miss Gates, is that you in there?
Sophie frowned. The voice was familiar.
Who is it?
It's Adam Quinn, miss, from the president's house. Is that you, Miss Gates?
Adam Quinn? Sophie lifted her brows, frowning into the darkness. What on earth?
But she was already undoing the locks, ridiculously relieved that it was him and not the rebels.
Unless he was with the rebels.
No, of course not. He knew Mr. Lincoln, and he said he'd come from the president's house. Maybe he was trying to hide from the army that seemed to still be marching over the bridge. She shivered. Just how many men were there on the long bridge coming to take the city? Her knees wobbled a little.
Come in. She stepped back as soon as the locks were undone and raised her rifle, just to be certain.
When Mr. Quinn opened the door to reveal himself, he stilled at the sight of the barrel pointing at him.
Well, I reckon I wasn't expecting such a warm greeting, Miss Gates.
His drawling comment nagged a smile from her, and she lowered the rifle.
Are you alone? Come inside. What on earth are you doing out there? Don't you know the rebels are coming across the bridge? Did they see you? Did you see them? How many are there?
Still holding his own rifle, her visitor closed the door behind him. Along with him came the brisk chill of the damp spring night and the faint scent of wood smoke and tobacco. In the soft golden glow, Sophie looked up at the man she'd learned was a close friend and confidant of the president during a recent murder investigation. He was nearly as tall as Mr. Lincoln, which he personally had cause to know, having once been in the same room with both men. That had been the most exciting day of her life, standing in the president's office and being commended by him for helping to catch a murderer. Her alter ego, Henry Altman, had written that story, and it had been Sophie's second published piece. Not in the New York Times, unfortunately, but in the much smaller, less prestigious Washington Republic. Still, it had been published.
Where's your uncle?
Surely you're not here alone, Miss Gates. Mr. Quinn set his rifle against the wall, swept off his unfashionable wide-brimmed hat, spraying her with a soft rain of water from the drizzle that had been falling all day.
I don't know where he is. He's been gone for hours. What are you doing here?
She went to the side light to look out, unable to see the long bridge from this view.
Did you see the soldiers? How many are there?
He left you here alone? With the Confederates coming?
Not exactly,
Sophie replied, still contorting herself to look out the window.
I can't see the soldiers.
Mr. Quinn sighed. I reckon I won't get any straight answers from you until I give you what you want. Those aren't the rebels crossing the bridge, Miss Gates.
They're not?
She pulled away from the window and looked at him curiously. He was really quite tall, and somehow the only part of his face that was caught by the lamplight was the nice little cleft in his clean-shaven chin. The rest of him was mostly in shadow, though she could see a hint of unruly dark hair and long, straight nose. No, they're my men from the president's house.
Your men? How many do you have out there? 200? 300?
Sophie had heard enough buzzing rumors to know that when Mr. Lincoln had called up the city militia over the last 3 days, barely half of the men had signed on. They weren't willing to actually shoot at their southern brethren, and some of them had even left the city to head south and enlist in the Confederate Army. But the troops she heard marching over the bridge sounded far more numerous and impressive than the low count that had been mustered. Mr. Quinn chuckled.
That's what we're trying to make everyone think. There's only a dozen.
Well, now, if I'm talking to a reporter, I best be careful what I say. But Sophie caught on quickly.
You mean you're creating a lot of noise to make it sound like there are more men than there are?
She grinned. That's smart. The sound carries across the water, too.
So the Confederates on the Virginia side of the river will hear all that noise. Maybe they'll think twice about coming over here tonight. He looked down at her speculatively. Now, you're not going to be telling your Southern friends about that little trick, are you? My Southern friends? I'm from New York City, Mr. Quinn. I don't have any friends in the South. She felt his eyes fasten on her. But your uncle does, and he's made no secret where his sympathies lie. I'm not my uncle, Mr. Quinn. I form my own opinions. I reckon you do at that, Miss Gates. His voice wasn't quite as slow as a Mississippi drawl, but it took its time and had a low, rough edge to it. She knew he'd lived on the frontier in Kansas for a while, which explained his informal manner, unfashionable clothing, and sun-browned skin. She suspected, though she didn't know for certain, that it was during the Free State battles that he lost his left arm. He wore a prosthetic instead of an empty coat sleeve, and he was so comfortable manipulating it that Sophie wouldn't be able to tell which was the false one if she didn't know it was his left arm. Is it true there are soldiers at the president's house? He asked. I saw them marching along the avenue. Yes, he looked at her with consideration, as if still questioning where her loyalties were. Maybe you'd want to tell your uncle about the hundreds of men you heard marching across the Long Bridge tonight. Maybe I do, if he ever comes back. You don't know where he is? When did he leave? How did you come to be here alone with the rebels at our shores? Sophie still kept peering out the window. Are you sure those are all your men? And what do you mean by your men? Mr. Quinn sighed again. I reckon you'd taken up the right vocation as a newspaper reporter, Miss Gates. You're more full of questions than answers. But I'm not answering any more questions until you do some of mine. I suppose you have a point. Yes, I am here alone. Uncle Joseph didn't exactly leave me here. He doesn't know I'm back. Back? It only took him an instant to catch on. So your aunt and cousins evacuated and you sneaked back? Is that how it happened? Your uncle was supposed to be here and now he's gone, probably at the National or Willard's, drinking with his friends and waiting for the invaders to come. She frowned up at him. Why are you asking me so many questions if you already know the answers? He shrugged, his wide shoulders shifting in the golden light. I reckon I might have made a good reporter myself if it didn't require talking to people. Sophie choked on a laugh. Well, you're an honest one, aren't you, Mr. Quinn? You don't like talking to people. He shrugged again. Most of the time, I'd just as soon be in a quiet location with my own company. Then what are you doing living in Washington City? She couldn't help but ask. I ask myself that nearly every day, Miss Gates, he said. There was a touch of levity in his voice, but it evaporated when he changed the subject. What about the others? The Megatherium Club, did they evacuate too? The Megatherium Club was the name adopted by the group of naturalists who boarded in the North Tower. All in their 20s and 30s, the men were hard workers during the day but acted like a wild brotherhood at night. A few weeks ago, Sophie had infiltrated one of their nighttime club meetings as Henry Altman, and Mr. Quinn had been present as well. She supposed she still owed him a favor since he hadn't exposed her real identity to the men who worked for her uncle, or to her uncle himself, for that matter. That realization caused her to temper her tone into a more conciliatory one. Yes, they're all gone as well. Uncle Joseph was going to stay because, well, you already know, he wasn't afraid of the Confederates. But he also wanted to make sure nothing happened to anyone here at the museum. And you sneaked back so you could be here to report the story. What on earth did you tell your aunt? I gave a note to one of my cousins to give to her later. We were all riding in a long caravan with some other friends in their carriages, and Aunt Harriet won't even realize I'm missing until they get to Baltimore. Baltimore? They're threatening to close the railways there and not allowing anyone to go north or to come south from Delaware or Pennsylvania. I don't know how far your family is going to get, Mr. Quinn sounded concerned. My aunt has family in Baltimore. They're Confederate sympathizers, too, Sophie admitted dryly. Yet another reason I didn't want to go with them. I've heard arguments on both sides about this conflict, and I can see the perspective of both the Union and the South. But I don't think war is the answer, and states just can't decide to leave the country if they don't like who gets elected president. That's not the point of our democracy, is it? I reckon we can't be the United States of America if those states can come and go as they please, not to mention the issue of enslaving other men. The bite in his otherwise relaxed drawl alerted her to his change of mood. Are you an abolitionist, Mr. Quinn? I reckon I am, Miss Gates. I lost property, peace, blood, and a limb fighting to keep Kansas free, because I don't believe any man has the right to keep any other man like a possession. She crossed her arms over her middle. And does that belief include not treating a woman, a wife, a mother, a sister, like a possession as well? Like a half-wit, or less of a person than a man, unable to make her own decisions? His eyes widened. Well, now, that's a sharp turn of conversation, Miss Gates. I merely ask because I suspect the next thing out of your mouth is going to be an admonishment to me about being here, a female alone, when the city is about to be invaded by an army. He took his time answering, and for some reason that annoyed her a little. In my mind, it's not advisable for anyone to be alone when an army is about to invade a city, man or woman, even if they do know how to hold a rifle. And load and shoot one, even if. I saw the light on in the tower, and as I know Dr. Henry lives here with his family, I thought it would be a good idea to check in and make sure everyone was all right when we came down here to march on the bridge. And, he added a bit more firmly as she tried to speak over him, I had a sneaking suspicion that a young woman who fancies herself a newspaper writer might have decided to investigate the situation. Well, now that you've proven yourself correct, I suppose you'd best see to your men, Sophie replied. This man was far too clever for his own good. No wonder Mr. Lincoln had put him in charge of investigating the murder of Custer Billings last month. Does that mean you've enlisted, Mr. Quinn, in the Union Army? Then she could have kicked herself. Of course he couldn't enlist with a missing arm. Not yet, was his rumbling response. He didn't seem to notice her faux pas, not officially, but it's only a matter of time now that things are going the way they are. But for tonight and for the foreseeable future, I'll be guarding the president in his house, along with the other men of the Frontier Guard. The Frontier Guard. So that's who is marching to the mansion today. They said it was General Lane. Do you know General Lane? She couldn't keep the light of admiration from her voice, the heroism of Jim Lane during the Mexican War and during the bloody Kansas conflict, had been all over the papers, which of course she'd read avidly, as a hopeful journalist as well as an American. Fought with him in Kansas. You were a Jayhawker? Sophie tried not to sound too impressed, but it was difficult not to. The stories that had come back to New York about the fierce frontier warriors led by the wild General Lane were both thrilling and terrifying. He was a national hero, despite the nasty business related to the death of one Gaius Jenkins. Some said Lane had murdered him in cold blood. Others said he'd been provoked, but the courts had ruled the case self-defense.
So, it is true. There are soldiers garrisoned in the executive mansion.
For the foreseeable future, the Confederates will come, if not tonight, then tomorrow or the next day.
They'd be fools not to act quickly before reinforcements come from the north, and God knows how soon they'll arrive.
He reached over to take up his gun.
Miss Gates, I reckon one rifle ain't going to do much good against a whole army, whether it be a man or a woman holding it.
She understood his point. Uncle Joseph should be back soon.
There's no telling when or if he'll be back. For all you know, he might have decided to follow your aunt and cousins to Baltimore.
Why don't you come on back to the president's house with us, at least for tonight?
But he kept talking in that easy drawl.
More important, Miss Gates, I'd consider it a personal favor. If my mother ever found out I left a woman by herself when an army was coming to invade the city, I wouldn't have enough skin left on me to hold my bones together, not to mention what she'd do to my ears and the rest of me.
Sophie couldn't hold back a laugh, mainly because he sounded deadly serious.
Well, I suppose that would be a waste of a good Union soldier, then.
She drew in a deep breath in an effort to settle her pulse.
Stay at the president's house? What better place for a news correspondent to be?
All right, then, I'll just go up and get a few things.
Yes, ma'am, he said gravely. I'll be right here, waiting. And watching.
He didn't say it, but he didn't have to. And as Sophie dashed up the stairs of the East Tower, she could admit to herself that she was relieved not to be left alone when the invaders were coming. It wasn't until she was on her way back down the stairs that she realized the president's house might not be much safer.
But at least she wouldn't be alone.
To everyone's surprise, the rebels didn't come that night. Dawn broke over a tense, half-empty city, like a sigh of relief revealing silent streets under a wash of pink. True to his word, Jim Lane had slept at Lincoln's second-floor bedroom door, his long legs stretched out in front of it. He'd kept three weapons with him through the night: a bayoneted rifle, a revolver, and his Arkansas toothpick, a long, slender, wicked-looking knife. Located on the main floor, the East Room, which was the largest and most updated chamber in the entire mansion, was occupied by the men of the Frontier Guard. Two massive fireplaces cast dancing shadows over the occupants while keeping the April damp at bay. When not taking turns at guard duty, each man slept head to wall on the red velvet carpet. Their feet faced the center of the room, and they lined their Enfield rifles and bayonets in a long metallic row down the middle.
"No pillows," Lane said. He wanted everyone to sleep, but to sleep lightly enough to come awake at the first sound.
It was nearly 10 o'clock by the time Adam turned Miss Gates over to the other females on the second floor, some wives of Frontier Guard members, Mrs. Lincoln, and her relatives. Then he left the mansion to once again march 2 dozen men back and forth across the long bridge, creating as much noise as possible before returning to the mansion just after 11 o'clock. In Lincoln's office with General Scott, Jim Lane, the President, and Hunter, Adam shared the news of several Confederate campfires along the Virginia shore of the Potomac. But in the dark, it was impossible to see how many troops, if any, there were. This worked to the advantage of the Frontier Guard as well, and Lane and Adam agreed that their tactic of making so much noise on the bridge might have contributed to the hesitation of the rebels to attack. Neither side could know how many men the others had. Lincoln went to bed at 11:30, and Lane took up his post outside his bedchamber door. Nevertheless,
when the morning dawned without an invasion. The relief was tempered. If not last night, then tonight. If not tonight, then tomorrow night. Meanwhile, they tensely waited for word of reinforcements from Massachusetts, New York, and Ohio. Several hours after the peaceful dawn, the small frontier guard was eating eggs, dried apples, and ham in the East Room. Lincoln was meeting with his advisors. The women were dressing in the bedchambers.
And then someone screamed.
Chapter 3. Friday, April 19th. Breakfast dishes and weapons clattered as they were dropped and snatched up respectively, and every man in the East Room was instantly on his feet. They rushed to the windows, to the door, spilling out into the hall, ready for any threat. Adam, who'd been halfway down the stairs, passing the ever-present line of job seekers who still showed up this morning despite the tensions in the city, spun around and bolted back up. The scream had come from the second floor, past the offices. By the time he got to the top of the stairs, the feminine screaming had...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.